also has its office related with hardware, and it's a physical layer detection of hardware key loggers, something you don't see a lot of.
Thank you for having me. So I'm here to present some joint work then with a student of mine, Satoshi Ramala. He has graduated and is not able to be here, so that's why I am going to present. Talking about hardware key loggers. A hardware key logger is simply a device that sits between a keyboard and a computer. It's generally a microcontroller or an ASIC, and what it does is it measures the electrical signals going from the keyboard to the PC, and converts that into a key press. There are many, many types of key loggers out there. They're abundant and they are cheap. So in our research, we found at least 8 manufacturers. They produce key loggers somewhere in the range of $30 to $400, depending upon those features that you're interested in. Features include things like capacity, size, point of attachment, retrieval mechanisms. Here are some examples. PS2 and USB. Key loggers, 4 gigabytes with Wi-Fi retrieval. They also sell some specifically for embedding in your keyboard or in a PCI slot. You can also make these yourself. They're very easy. I have my students in their embedded systems lab actually make a hardware key logger 1 week. You'll find open source designs online for wireless and wired key loggers. And they even include PCB layouts for you. I suppose we should actually say that this is at least 9 manufacturers. The NSA is also known to manufacture key loggers. Trinity here is a microcontroller, an FPGA, and memory. You attach that to a Howler Monkey, and you get wireless transmission of key presses. This over here, it's actually called the Surly Spawn, is a retroflector. I'll talk more about those at the end of the talk, but this is a way to remotely acquire keystrokes using very, very little or no power. Hardware key loggers are present in the wild, so we find them used for personal gain here, personal political gain. Here's another instance of that. Also corporate governments or personal espionage, we're not sure in this case. German journalist was attaching key loggers to his colleagues' computers. Finally, just good old theft. Barnes & Noble case, there's not a lot of technical details out there. As far as I can tell, what happened is criminals broke in and they modified the physical keypads that you used to enter your credit card information by adding a device there. The way we like to characterize these key loggers, at least the way that we do in the paper, is by looking at their power. Are they going to be self-powered? That is, will they have a battery, maybe some recharging facilities, or will they acquire power from the power source of the key logger? An active key logger is one that actually sits between the PC and the keyboard and measures the signals. Okay? It measures them and then it regenerates them. So it actually breaks this connection. It would measure the signal from the keyboard and then forward that on to the PC. These are the most common commercially available key loggers we have found. A passive key logger, and this is what we'll be focusing on, or we did focus on, actually sits in parallel with the keyboard and the PC. It's passive in that way that it doesn't have to intercept and then regenerate the signals. If the active key logger doesn't regenerate the key press, then it never happened. So this variety of key logger is just going to eavesdrop on the signal. Existing detection and mitigation techniques fall into 4 categories. One is avoidance. The idea here is that whenever the user needs to enter sensitive information, have them use an on-screen keyboard. These tend to be very tedious, they're not practical if there are bystanders nearby and they're vulnerable to screen capture, although there is some work that gets rid of this particular vulnerability. The next category is detection. Visual detection is the first method of detection. This is impractical at large scales, so if you can't have IT staff going around checking 25,000 computers in your organization every day for a hardware key logger. Also, we don't want to have to disassemble machines to look for hardware keyloggers. If the keylogger is designed to fit inside of your laptop keyboard, the only way to actually check to see if it's there is take your laptop apart. Again, impractical. There was some earlier work done on inline detection of hardware keyloggers, and this looked at the timing and the power. The reason they were doing power is because these were not self-powered devices. They would draw from the power line of the keyboard. You could see the little extra power there if you used special equipment. Timing came about because for an inline device, it has to first measure it, figure out what it's measured, and then replay that information. Exhaustion is the third technique. This is a first mitigation technique. The idea here is that you would just send spurious commands or key presses between the PC and the keyboard, or the keyboard and the PC, and hopefully you would fill up the memory of the keylogger. Hardware keyloggers, however, have gigabytes of memory now. If you're doing 10 key presses per second, which is realistic for PS2, it is going to take 109 minutes just to fill up 64K of memory. So this work was actually done by the author of this paper here. He concluded that this was just not practical. The last one is obfuscation. So let us say that our keyboard shares some random value or a key with our PC. Well, then we can encrypt all of our messages, or just transmit random streams of bytes, and the PC then knows which one is the genuine key press. The problem with this is the key matrix in the keyboard is still vulnerable. I just have to plug the keyboard logger in directly to the mechanical switches or electrical switches on the keyboard to be able to do the tapping. I'm also not aware of this being actually used in practice. I'm sure there are some government agencies where they encrypt stuff between the keyboard and the PC. I've just not seen them. Finally, there is one other method of detection. It's called tap detection. And this was hinted, if you go back and read a paper in 2006 on device fingerprinting or physical layer identification, the authors mentioned that you might be able to detect taps on a line that's just some device that's listening on the line, because it would change the fingerprint of the device being fingerprinted. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. So, the threat model that we use for our work, we've assumed a microcontroller-based hardware keylogger. As long as you're using the same fabrication technology, it doesn't matter if it's microcontroller or an ASIC. The detection approach works just the same. Also, our keylogger is passive, right? It sits in parallel or alongside the PC. This is because those inline keyboards, our keyloggers, they've already been examined in the literature, but also, given the work that's been done in device fingerprinting, we think that a device that reads a signal and then replays it would be easily detectable. That is, it would be very easy for the PC to look at the IC, or the microcontroller that was regenerating the signal, and say, okay, the fingerprints don't match between those two devices. We already know that we can do this for wired devices, Ethernet devices, which are running much faster than the keylogger, so this shouldn't be a problem. Our keylogger is stealthy in that it is self-powered. It's also evasive, and by evasive I mean a hardware keylogger that takes steps to conceal its presence. Ours is ipso facto evasive to its existing techniques. All existing techniques cannot identify our keylogger because it sits in parallel. We also consider optimal attacks to our detection approach, and we'll get to those later on. Okay, it is a PS2 hardware keylogger. One, we did that because the PS2 protocol is much easier to explain, as you'll see here in a couple of slides. But more importantly, from an electrical perspective, the line drivers of a PS2 keyboard and a USB keyboard are electrically equivalent. Okay, the load impedances do not change, which is what we actually care about here. And in fact, we believe that the USB keyboard, because it is operating at a higher frequency, would be easier to detect. I'll get to this at the end of the presentation. So finally, the hardware keylogger is placed right in between the PC and the keyboard. This doesn't actually limit our detection approach because we're assuming a lumped element model. That is, you can ignore transmission lines or the wave nature of electricity because the distances are much, much smaller. The distances of the wire is much, much less than the wavelength of the signaling. Right? That means our tap point is actually immaterial. We can detect a hardware keylogger if it's embedded in the keyboard or if it's between the keyboard and the PC in the PS2 module. PS2, it has four lines that we care about, power, clock, ground, and data. So this is a synchronous communication protocol. It's idle at 5 volts. Data is read by the PC on the falling edge. So this is what the signal looks like. You have data in blue when we press the space key, and then in green you have the clock. What's interesting about this protocol is that it is bi-directional. Your PC does need to send data to the keyboard occasionally, even if it's just, say, the number of lights. That needs to be consistent between the internal state of the PC and the keyboard. Also, the keyboard generates the clock in this configuration. Based upon this signaling here, I think it's pretty easy to drive a hardware keylogger. What we would want to do is take our microcontroller, connect it in parallel with the keyboard. Our data pins, the GPIO pins on the hardware keylogger then get connected to the data in the clock line. Anytime we have a negative transition on the clock line, that causes an interrupt on the GPIO pin associated with the clock line. We jump into an ISR, and we then read the data pin. The way that we detect the hardware keyloggers then is based upon what's known as the observer effect. Some of you may know it as the Heisenberg effect. Right? The idea here is that just by measuring something, you affect it. This is manifested at the electrical level, what we're using, via loading. So let's say that you have a very high impedance load and you attempt to measure it with a voltmeter. The voltmeter is supposed to have a high impedance load, or is supposed to be high impedance as well. When you combine those two together, you get a lower impedance. So we use loading to be able to detect the hardware keylogger. Let me show you how we do that. We will assume that we can represent the clock on our keyboard as just a voltage source. That voltage source has some output impedance, we'll call it RKB. The PC then is just represented by our regular impedance as well. These are purely real, so they are resistances. Now, a passive hardware keylogger then gets represented, if it's in parallel, by a resistor and a capacitor. So we use a complex impedance to represent the hardware keylogger. The resistance and the capacitance correspond to the input resistance and the capacitance of the GPIO pins used in the microcontroller to build the hardware keylogger. Let's look at the effect of both of these. So, ignoring for a moment this input resistance, the order of this is on the tens or hundreds of ohms, this is mega ohms, this is probably going to be picofarads, I can't see it, it's cut off. If we ignore, for instance, just to start off with, the output impedance of our clock source, we have this. Now, if we go from a high to a low, what that actually is just the natural response of our circuits. So we can say that the line voltage here is given by this equation, where tau is our time constant, which we can calculate by combining these two resistances in parallel, multiplied by our capacitance. What this means is that with a hardware keylogger, instead of having a nice fast transition from a high to a low state, we'll have exponential decay. We can use this then to detect a hardware keylogger because the time it takes to go from a logic high to a logic low should be greater for a hardware keylogger, or at least when a hardware keylogger is present. To verify this, we did some experiments. So we're assuming that the parallel resistance is going to be on the order of kilo ohms. That is, we have mega ohm for the PC, mega ohm for the hardware keylogger. That should be a kilo ohms, assuming capacitance is on the order of picofarads, we're looking at a time constant on the order of nanoseconds. We can do these measurements, we just have to use a very expensive scope to do it. Very, very fast, 40 gigasamples per second. When we do the measurements, you can see them here, we're going from a low state to a high state in this case. There is, in fact, a difference between the rise times. So the blue is without the hardware keylogger, and the red is with the hardware keylogger. And it does take the hardware keylogger a little bit more time to get up to the top. Unfortunately, it's not very much. Right? So these are the 99% intervals of the mean of the rise times and the fall times with the keylogger and without the keylogger. Okay, they're different, but not very much. Right? You can see how those means are changing. The implication here is that we should be ignoring capacitance then. We'll bring this back later on when we have to consider an attacker is attempting to evade our approach. But ignore our capacitance, and let's reintroduce the output impedance of our clock. We can now rewrite the line voltage, for this case, this way here. When we attach the hardware keylogger, we have to rewrite the line voltage this way. So we have L prime without the hardware keylogger, so ignore that, and then L prime with the hardware keylogger. And this beta here is just a multiple. We're assuming that our resistance for our keylogger is just proportional to the resistance of the PC. So they're on the same order of magnitude. Now assuming that the keylogger and the PC were built using the same process technology, beta should be approximately 1. The voltage when the hardware keylogger is present is always less than when it is not, as long as that beta does not equal infinity. If we use the previous estimates for our resistances and capacitances, we should see a difference on the order of millivolts. And, in fact, when we connect our keylogger and we make measurements, and then we make measurements without it, we do, in fact, see a difference on the order of millivolts. So about 20 millivolts for this particular PC. These are just the average values of the low portion of the clock signal. This model is assuming that resistances are constant over all voltage levels, but in fact they are not. So if we look at one microcontroller, it has a constant leakage current of 1 microamp. So at 25 millivolts down here basically, we would expect to have an input impedance of a microcontroller of 25 kiloohms. So we should have a difference in voltages of on the order of a millivolt. But at 3.3 volts, our input impedance is going to be on the order of mega ohms. We should expect to see 10 millivolt drops. This means that if we're trying to detect a hardware keylogger based upon the level, we should use the higher voltage levels instead of the lower voltage levels. Our detection architecture looks like this. We have our sampler, we're going to use a high resolution sampler here, this means it has a lot of bits. So a 12-bit sampler can be had for $3. Since it's PS2, the clock doesn't have to be very fast in this. That's why the sampler can be so inexpensive. We monitor only the clock and the ground. We don't actually care what key is being pressed. We just want to know if the attacker is using the clock line. Our F function here extracts the features, that is the voltage levels of our signal, and then we use some distance metric to compare the features we've just extracted to a reference set of features and see how close together they are. We'll store the reference features in the database. Right? This means we have to go through some sort of training period where we know there is no hardware keylogger. If you're familiar with the methodology of biometrics or device fingerprinting, this is the exact same methodology. Our F function then. We don't need to use anything fancy like PCA or factor analysis. The raw voltage readings themselves are sufficient. The first step we use, just align the captured signal to some reference signal so we know where we are in our sample space. Then we need to extract the different readings. So we want to know the high level values and the low level values here. So we extract readings for each of those separately. We only have to use 1.5 clocks for our detection approach. So we'll extract just these sample points here. That looks like this. We want, for the low sample points, we use sort of an ad hoc algorithm. What we just say is take the mean of all of these sample points, and and then we'll just select the points less than the mean, and from the remaining sample points, what we do is we take their mean, get the standard deviation, and then figure out which sample points are less than that. So we're left over with the sample points just below the green line here. And we do a similar process for the upper. I should note that as long as you do not have a hardware keylogger installed, the deviation in your voltage measurements from keypress to keypress should be the same. You should be able to see the same drop at the top as you do at the bottom. This is just another way that you could detect the presence of a hardware keylogger. Now, ideally, in the ideal case, what we could do is just take the mean of these sample points, compare it to a threshold. If the mean is less than a threshold, then we don't have a hardware keylogger. Unfortunately, our clock signal is stochastic. So what you're seeing over here is a 99% confidence intervals for a particular keyboard where we're looking at the mean of all of the samples captured, or all of the keypresses captured without the hardware keylogger and with. You can see that the means are different, but there's overlaps here in the confidence intervals. Right? They overlap, but the means are different, so we can still tell them apart. Right? Variances are also possibly different. This means we need to use multiple keypresses in order to detect the presence of a hardware keylogger. The way it works, we simply find out the sample points we're interested in down here in the lower clock or in the upper clock. We build a distribution from the multiple key presses, and then we compare that to a reference distribution. We use the earth remover's distance, which is just the cost of transforming one histogram into another. If the distance between our training data and our test data is less than some threshold, then we say that we have no hardware keylogger. Our experimental setup looked something like this. So we have a tap point between our keyboard and our PC. The hardware keylogger is connected only to the clock and the ground signal. In this case, we used a Teva C microcontroller. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. Our keyboards are PS2 keyboards. We actually needed to use a USB to PS2 converter because our test PC over here doesn't have a PS2 port. The USB DAC we used was a measurement computing at 1 meg sample per second. It's 16 bits. This means we can measure voltage differences as small as 153 microvolts if needed. Here's a picture of our hardware keylogger. You can see that it's connected here to the clock and the ground, and we have a tap point up here. So one end of the tap goes to the PC, the other goes to the computer. This is a Cortex-M4 device. It's self-powered, of course. This is where the power is coming from. We also left the input pins of the GPIO ports floating in this case. You would not generally want to do that because noise then is able to bring your line state high or low. So we did this because even though it reduces the reliability of the hardware keylogger, it should make it more difficult to detect, because if we have pull-up resistors, that would affect the load impedance of the line. We connect only the clock, as I said, because the actual key presses are irrelevant in this case. We just want to know, is something connected to the clock line? So in our interrupt service routine, which is triggered by a falling edge of the clock, we just blink our LED over here so that we know we've registered the key press. Here's the complete setup. We have a motor controller here. This just generates a 20% duty cycle square wave with a period of about 1.5 seconds. That is connected to a switch back here, which goes into a linear controller, or a linear motor, excuse me. Every time this is set to on, switch is closed, and the motor presses the spacing key. Very crude, but effective. Our USB DAC here, it is set to trigger a falling edge, and we save just 35 milliseconds of data. All of this is being run on this PC here, see at the back. It's just running MATLAB. So how did things turn out? We used 25 keyboards. This is from two manufacturers, Dell and Logitech. They came from two places of origin, China and Thailand. And in all, there were 10 different models. We took 100 keypresses without a keylogger attached, and then we took another 1,000 right after that. We were trying to reduce environmental variables here. So we did no keylogger, and then immediately keylogger. And this takes about 50 minutes. On average, the voltage difference for the upper level is 23.7 millivolts. difference, the reason that we have differences between these two are because the input impedance of our microcontroller varies with the voltage level. At the upper level, we have somewhere between 83 and 166 kilo-ohms. This means we should have about a 30 millivolts drop, which we see. For the lower level, on the other hand, we have somewhere between 25K and 25 mega-ohm. At 25 mega-ohm, we should see a 471 microvolt drop. So we're probably somewhere around 2.5 mega-ohms. Now, we're concerned about two things. One, the number of key presses that we need to use to detect the hardware key logger because of that natural variation. We'll call that N. The other, we use 256 of the individual readings for all of the detection approaches. So to build up this distribution, we used up to 256 sample points taken from the N key presses, selected at random. The threshold for our approach was set using the equal error rate condition. That is, the threshold is set such that your false positives are equal to your false negatives. False positives in this case mean that we detect hardware keylogger when there is no keylogger present. False negative is the converse case. We fail to detect the hardware keylogger when it is in fact present. We achieved an equal error rate of zero, meaning no false positives and no false negatives, when, for the upper level, we used 10 key presses. You can see here is our threshold. We have separation between our, this is the distance, we have separation between our no key logger case and our key logger case here. If we use the lower level, we need to use 25 key presses. Now, we can also combine this. So the combined approach uses only 5 key presses. So with the 5 key presses, we stipulate that the threshold for the upper and the threshold for the lower has to be met. It only takes 5 key presses. So actually, it works very well, even with just a single key press. You can see that our mean equal error rate is about 8% in that case. Again, we noticed a much larger drop at the upper level than the lower level. That's why it takes many fewer key presses over here for the upper level. The clock is stochastic. So are the features stable? So the distances between these measurements should change over time. The question is, do we need to set up new training periods? For the upper level, no. Our features are stable. For the lower level, no. We do have to set up new training data. Right? This means you actually have to re-authenticate the keyboard every time you turned off the computer. Right? Here you will see 1,000 keyboard signals overlaid at 2 different times. You can see that there is a very perceptible shift. We wanted to know, is that caused by temperature? So we set up an experiment. We measured 4 different points of interest. 2 samples per second for 24 hours. Then we did a regression. So we wanted to know, is the mean of the lower clock proportional to the temperature? It is. 0.99 R squared. So we are able to actually adapt the feature if we need to. That is, we can move the voltage level. Countermeasures. All device fingerprinting or PLI techniques are vulnerable to relay. What this would look like for an attacker is they have an analog to digital converter, they measure the signal, and then they replay it so that the signal they replay looks exactly like the keyboard signal. We don't think that this will be effective for a few reasons. One, analog to digital converters and digital analog converters exhibit their own loading effects because they have finite impedances. You could compensate for this loading by doing measurements of the PC and the keyboard, but you have to have the PC on, and then you have to disconnect the keyboard, which we would be able to detect. These are also very energy intensive, much more than just general GPIO. It does need to be bidirectional as well, which complicates things. And you could probably just take the DAC out if you periodically shorted the clock line. That would burn it out. More threatening is the passive key logger. The attacker's idea is to minimize the difference between the voltage This can be accomplished by using very high input impedance. You can get such input, or you can engineer such input impedances using a comparator. Here we have a teraohm of input impedance. We can no longer detect voltage drops then. But you get a much higher rise time. So an optimal detect, optimal attack selects the resistance for the keylogger here. So it's just large enough to evade the level of detection. This will minimize the time constant. We showed if you were able to detect voltage differences at resolution R, this is the optimal input impedance that the PC should see. If we assume a capacitance for a keylogger of 1.5 picofarads, which is very, very generous, your time constant is on the order of microseconds. So we did actually validate this as well. We connected a potentiometer to find out what input impedance would fool our level detection, and then we inserted, instead of our hardware keylogger, we used a 3 picofarad capacitor, and then we made some measurements to see if we could detect changes in the transient. You can do this at 125 megasamples per second. You don't need a $2,000 scope. You can use a 15-bit ADC to do this. And using the Kolbach-Leibler divergence, we are actually able to distinguish rise times between the keylogger case and the no keylogger case. So here is our final then transient analysis. For USB detection, it is still detectable because it is such high frequency. It is asynchronous, that's okay. Every packet starts with a synchronization signal. We can just use those for detection. I ran a couple of simulations that show you this is the ideal case. If we connect an 8 picofarad load, you can see what happens to the transient. This just represents the measurements. Right? We use 3 picofarads for the hardware keylogger, and then you can see there's a difference between the measurement transient and the picofarad, the hardware keylogger. So it's still detected. Conclusion, I did want to mention for future work, we need long-term observation. We need to look at the thresholds, how they can be set adaptively. Also, how can we disable proactively these hardware keyloggers? Ideally, we would want features that are invariant with respect to the PC and the keyboard or fingerprinting. Oh, and one of the reviewers mentioned retroflectors. If you are here, I will talk to you about that. I think we can detect these as well. The idea behind a retroflector is you just connect a little switch to the data line. That will open or close this MOSFET. You send an RF signal at it. That RF signal gets modulated according to the data. No power here, still loading. Thank you.
Questions, but maybe we have time for one burning question till our next speaker sets up.
Thank you for your talk, Xiaobei from Virginia Tech. You just gave an interesting concept that when you intercept a signal to tap it, then you can maybe have some influence on the signal and that enables you to detect it. My question is, can you give some comments on some type of maybe another type of keylogger that can be considered as some channel attack, so that people use the noises that people type the keyboard to try to detect which key the user is tapping, and then to get something functioning similarly to a keylogger. So can you give some comments of maybe detecting this type of side channel keyloggers? And
you can detect key presses using motion sensors, for instance, or acoustic emanations. Our work requires a direct electrical connection. I would just say if your detector uses any sort of oscillator, we would be able to detect it. Okay? We could just pick it up wirelessly through the air as a side channel.